Do you think I need to go and paint that yellow BR, bruv? Arms out to your mum's house. Arms out to your mum's house. To your mum's house. Arms out to your mum's house. Oh, there we go. Ah, but I don't think we can hear you.
Como estás, mi pana? Connecting the audio. There she goes.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, I can hear you now.
I'm good.
Amazing.
He's in.
Yeah, man. Finally.
Yes.
Yo.
Wow. Just so you know, we're recording now, man. I've started the recording. But don't worry, I'm going to edit it in the edit. And, you know, hopefully I don't edit it too much, but I just neaten it up slightly. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, man.
Excellent.
How you doing, Mark? How you doing?
Good, good, good. Just
where are you?
Huh?
Where are you?
This is in my living room. See the painting of my dad that my uncle Vincent Bodē painted in oil. It's an oil painting.
Wow,
a proper oil painting on canvas.
You know, it's like, you know.
Oh yeah.
There we go, man. Oh my god. Props. I've seen that image before, you know, online and stuff.
And you got a scene over here. Richie and I did this canvas.
Damn.
Nice, man.
Yeah.
Incredible stuff, man. I mean, man, okay. So, like, where to even begin, man? We have the legendary! the amazing.
Amazing!
Mark Bodē in the house. Actually, let's start off with this very important point. I've heard it said as Bodē. I've heard it said as Bode. I've heard it said as Bodē.
Bodē. In France, they say Bodē.
Let's just set the record straight off the bat, man.
It's Bidé.
Bidé. Yeah, okay. Yo, you gotta wash your ass, man. No, I'm kidding.
We wash the world. Yeah. No, it's Bodē. Yeah, my father put the long E over the E.
Yes.
Yeah.
And it became, you know, it was Bodē, supposed to be a long E. But back in his day, you know, there was no computers. And, you know, when they would put it in type, it would become an accent. You know, there was only an accent.
Uh-huh, yes.
So whenever it went into print, it was Bodē.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
That's where it began, where the graffiti artists would say Bodē, ah, you know, like you do a Bodē, you know, character.
Yeah, but yeah.
It wasn't actually Bodē, it's Bodē. Yeah.
Okay, cool. All right, that's a great place.
I've had people, you know, I've introduced myself, oh, I'm Mark Bodē. And they're like, yeah, whatever, dude. And then and then a minute later, somebody goes, that's Bodē. Like, oh, yeah. You know, like they would freak out. It was just like an accent problem.
Okay, so it's not just like an English American thing, like, you know what I mean, like aluminium, aluminum.
No, I mean the name is.
I was making a joke.
The name was German and French, and so it obviously it became a French accent, which is not correct.
Oh, but I always thought it was Dutch for some reason. I don't know why that. I don't know where that came from.
No, Alsace, you know, like Alsace-Lorraine over that way. There's a Bodē River. It's probably a polluted creek. but yeah, there's a Bodē River there, and that's where the family name comes from. But yeah,
incredible. I also wanted to kick this off on how this meeting came about, man, because we you know, obviously.
Oh yeah.
You know, your dad and your characters are predominantly used in graffiti, you know, and on a previous episode, I can't remember which one, I'll put a link to it below. I said a little thing that used to annoy me. Yeah. Well, started annoying me. And obviously I was being a bit hyperbolic in the clip that I posted, you know, obviously just to like gain traction or whatnot, but I feel it's an honest feeling of mine.
I don't like him now because everyone fucking does him. Well, it's like, what are we going to do? Oh, just do a Bodē character. And it just seems like a lack of imagination. Unless you do the Bodē doing something that I haven't seen before, you know? Like, for example...
Or it's on a train in New York.
I'm going to now put on the screen the Vaughn Bodē that every fucker does. It's here. This Vaughn Bodē character, if you go to Google, type in Vaughn Bodē and type and press images, it's like the third or fourth image down. Every guy, whenever I see this character, I see it from a mile away. When I see people copying it there, I'm like, what? You couldn't even scroll past the first page to look for a Vaughn Bodē character to look. You just come across the first one you saw. All right, I'll draw that one. That's just laziness to me, man.
There's a certain stance, pose of the green lizard that comes up on like the first one or two images when you search for the Bodē characters. And I just see people go for that one all the time. And I've seen it happen before me in front of my own eyes. People just going, oh, what should we do? Oh, stick a Bodē lizard. And then they just do that same pose. And I'm like, just fucking scroll a bit further, man. Find a different pose. Or what I would do normally, again, I don't want to like, you know, toot my own horn, but I'll go through all the comic books, you know, and I'll find the body from one lizard and then the head from another lizard and then like the hands from a different lizard, and I'll combine them to make an original version of it, you know what I mean, or put my little spin to it. And anyway, it kind of wound up a few people on your Facebook post when I posted it on your Facebook, and it got a lot of traction on there and a few interesting discussions as well.
When I first saw it, I was like, wow, this guy's got a lot of hate, needs a hug or something.
Yeah, there were some people were really laying into me, man. This guy, don't
know was like, you don't know nothing about Graf.
Yeah. I'm like the same, you know, like, you know, I've been around these characters since I was born. So they're like more like family or friends to me than they are characters, you know, like they help me, they go with me wherever I go. You know, but they are overused, certain poses. I could see that, you know, and it didn't irk me that you were venting. I feel that way sometimes myself. It's like, why are they ruining my legacy?
Well, I'll tell
what
you
are what. They doing
later you know, on.
Some of this stuff is really bad.
You know what? This is a great segue because I've prepared some stuff.
What do you feel like when you see one, you know, if you see a train or an old photo and someone's done the Bodē character really shit, you know, does that irk you in any way?
Can you see those lizards are like a product of a copy of a copy of a copy, you know, without seeing the comic books. So the lizard becomes kind of this gummy bear.
Like this guy over here.
That's hardly a lizard recognizably, but you could still tell where it came from.
Mm-hmm.
But that's kind of, my mom started republishing all the stuff my father did for magazines in the 60s and 70s. And in the 80s, my mom, you know, did a deal with Fantagraphics, and they started coming out with, you know, the compilated erotica books and Dead Bone and Lizard Zen and Cheech Wizard, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
But once that started coming out and people used to start getting the books, right?
Yeah.
And so then the characters started looking like they were supposed to again. But am I there?
Okay. Yes, you're here. But also I was going to say, Mark, like back in the day when you first started noticing on the trains these iterations of your dad's work, like that must have been one of the most surreal things to witness. I mean, not only just the graffiti phenomenon of the trains and the artwork that was being created, but then to see some familiar things, like you said, that was part of your childhood growing up. And that must have been so mad to see.
I've told the story so many times, but I first saw it. I was, you know, going to school visual arts in 1982, and I was waiting on a platform on 20, West or East 23rd, West 23rd. Yeah, West 23rd Street. And a nonstop went by, and I saw Deadbone Mountain and Cheech Wizard and the Lizards and the Bodhi Broads, and they all went by me like a flash, you
Wow.
know. And the wind hit me and the imagery hit me, and I was like, what maniac is risking his freedom to get my father's artwork up on the train? You know, what maniac? There's got to be this one insane guy, right?
This insane fan. Yeah.
It's out of control, his mind. But I thought it was just a one-off, you know? And then I moved back to San Francisco in late 82. And then I saw Bodhi characters in San Francisco. And I was like, it's more than one guy.
Wow.
And it's a whole movement.
It's a whole movement across the...
Yeah, and people just glommed onto it.
The country.
And it really was Dondi that made it really noticeably famous. I mean, Ree and Malo, Chino, I sent you a picture of the first graffiti train.
Ree Villamar, right? Is on Instagram.
Yes. But anyway, that's the first Cheech Wizard or Bodhi ever documented.
That's the first one.
The very first one. It was just after my father died. Ree had heard of my father's passing, and he did that from memory on the train, and somebody took a picture.
Mm-hmm.
There could have been ones before, but my father never saw it. You know,
I was gonna say, yeah. So he never got to see the legacy that is gonna.
He knew that his characters and his creations were bigger than comics, but he didn't know how or what or when. He just knew it was bigger, and he wasn't sure if it was gonna be toys or animation or movies or what have you.
Or panels.
Never thought of the underground art form. I mean, he was working in the underground, you know, pioneering the underground comics.
Yeah.
And
I mean,
a smooth move right over to underground art of graffiti. I mean, it's all underground, you know.
I was going to say, I mean, obviously I'm a big fan of the work, but I'm nowhere near like an expert or anything like this on the historicity and stuff. But like, did your dad actually get the accolades he deserved at the time before he passed?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, gosh, you know, if he had only lasted another year or two more, he would have had a couple of movies in the works. I mean, he was negotiating that stuff right as he died. But he received the Yellow Kid Award, which is the Academy Award for comics in France.
Okay.
Or actually received it in Italy at Lucca in 74. So he received that, and he was the second American cartoonist to ever win that. So he got the Academy Award from the European.
Incredible. And obviously the French and the Belgians, they don't mess around when it comes to comic books. So many incredible things have come from Tintin.
And he also won the Hugo. He won the Hugo Award for Cobalt 60 for best fanzine artist in 69. And that's a rocket ship. You know, they still give the award out today, but he wanted best artist. He didn't want best fanzine artist. So he didn't take the thing too seriously, but it's a Hugo, Dad. But, you know, he used it as a doorstop to his studio. And then he tried to launch it. You know, I remember going into the backyard, and he goes, this thing's going to the moon, son. And I'm like, remember going, oh my God, what's he doing? And like, he put a rocket engine in the bottom of the award and tried to launch it with the battery cables off our car. And it just went up a few feet, went around for a minute or two. And you know, so that,
damn.
Yeah,
he must have been such a trip. man. Like, you know, he sounds obviously just from his artwork. I only know him through the artwork, and he's like his mind, his imagination, his yeah.
He's right there. He's right there on my shoulder all the time.
Incredible. And I know you were super close. Like, what do you know inspired him? Do you know, like, what comic books or what cartoons or?
Yeah, well, there was obviously Disney. Disney was a big one because he would go to, he went to, as a 15-year-old boy, he went to see Walt Disney's Fantasia, the original one, that came out in the 40s. And he saw The Apprentice, you know, where Mickey and the brooms are, you know, Mickey wears the wizard hat.
Yeah, yeah.
Everything dance
around. Exactly, yeah.
Well, that was a eureka moment when Mickey gives the hat back to the wizard, and the wizard goes like this, like, dang! And it, you know, but it kinks at the top when he gives it back, just to add insult to injury. And my father went, "That's it." And he went home, drew feet on, legs on it, and there was Cheech Wizard. And he wrote it down. It was like 2:20 in the afternoon, September 26, 1957. And he wrote it down because he knew this Cheech Wizard was going to be special. And he wrote it down as a 15-year-old boy, you know.
Wow, man.
And a year later, he went to see Fantasia again, and he saw the Rites of Spring, where all the dinosaurs are, you know, come up out of the muck and start becoming dinosaurs. And then they get hit, you know, with an apocalyptic event, and they start dying. Well, there was a duck-billed dinosaur that was like dying, and then he falls into the muck. And my father took that duck-billed dinosaur, went home, and he drew
a dick on balls.
Put a head on it.
Yes, there we go.
Yes, and then it was all history after that.
Yeah, man. And then the hat kicked him in those fucking nuts, man. Man, yeah, and can I ask you, like, obviously you've obviously heavily inspired by your father's work, and it's, you know, part of the legacy and the heritage, but what inspires you now as well, like in this modern day? Obviously now it's kind of gone full circle because you're influenced by some graffiti writers, you know what I mean? And I don't know, like, maybe you can expand on that.
Well, it's always been, I mean, between my dad and I, my dad always was encouraging me as a young boy to draw and to use my imagination. But there's only one Vaughn, you know, and there's only one Mark, but he's immortal and I'm mortal, and we work together. It's just a family thing, you know. It's a family style. I protect it. I go after people who do multiples. You know, if it's skateboards or t-shirts or whatever, you got to come to me.
I like that.
I mean, it's copyright. It's copyright. A lot of people don't know about copyrights. You know, they just, I found this in the street. Yo, you know, like, yes, those are the shirts.
Yeah.
You know, and then they're surprised when I come knocking on their door and I'm like, hey, you know,
these are my lizards, yo.
We've even spoke not too long ago because obviously living in Europe, we definitely do trips to Amsterdam quite a lot, you know. And there was a particular coffee shop that I used to go to all the time. Obviously, all us graffiti writers used to go to coffee shop 36, you know.
Yeah.
And all the imagery was Bodē characters, man. And I heard there was some litigation or something, and you got them closed down or some shit.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I had to step up to that because
it was all over it. It was
somebody take the character like that and then run with it. If you don't do anything about it, that leaves a precedent for
other people
else to do it, and it'll come down and before you know it, your stuff's public domain and you have no control whatsoever. But I went to the owner and said, well, I went up buy some hash. I went up to the guy and I said, I would like to take this, this, and this, and this. And by the way, I'm the guy who owns the lizard. And he goes, oh, the alligator dude? And it's like, he's an alligator. He's a lizard, and I own him. And he goes, oh, so we are in trouble then. And I said, well, you could be. And then he charged me for the weed.
Oh, my God.
Like, you are definitely in trouble.
Yeah, exactly.
He called it a fucking alligator.
Like, take what you want. I would have been like, okay, we can work with this, Yeah. Let's see how this works out.
I mean, wasn't the sign on the shop, wasn't it the Bodē character that actually in the high street?
Yeah.
It was.
It
was their logo.
Yeah, I remember now.
It was the logo. Yeah, straight up and down.
Shop 36. She
bought the shop from somebody else who appropriated the lizard. I won't get into the actual graffiti artist that did it, because he was just a boy at the time and he didn't know any better. But the original owner was long gone, and she was stuck not knowing what this lizard was. And then here I am showing up. I own that. You owe
this
me.
This is my lizard.
So she was shocked, and I could tell, like I came out of nowhere.
Wow.
And we started to work things out. But then as soon as I returned to the States, her English got really bad. Like, I don't understand. I don't understand.
Yeah, very convenient.
I owe you? What?
Yeah.
It kind of reminds
me. We all
me
know that trick, love.
Yeah. It kind of reminds me a little bit as well in hip hop culture, in hip hop music. You know, a lot of those 90s artists were sampling old jazz and, rock and stuff from the 60s and 70s without getting clearance. And then years later, it comes back to bite them in the ass, But rightfully so. I mean, at the end of the day, if you're looping up a fucking Johnny Coltrane riff, you got to pay the estate, man. You know, if you're going to do it properly. But again, on the other side, on the flip, Mark, it seems to me like you, if it's for pleasure and you're doing something out of fandom, or like the graffiti writers painting a wall or a train, you're cool with that, right? It's just once you monetize it.
Oh, yeah. No, if it wasn't for the graffiti love, all the people who got the characters up, and I wouldn't have a career to stand on. I mean, I'd probably still be doing it, but I wouldn't have a platform that's so big, and it's all that love that people have for the characters, and like over the years, I always do my own thing too, and my own style is noticeably similar, but you can tell the difference between my dad and I, and I often just do what he always told me to do, which is like draw what you want, what excites you, and I'm still doing that, but more and more I'm realizing that he's immortal and I'm mortal, and we have to perpetuate the Bodē, legacy, and
of course,
and the characters are our family, and we got to protect them and spread them and spread the good word of the hat.
No doubt, man. No, and the beautiful voluptuous women that you draw, man. Would you say? Would
always you say, with the big booties.
The big booties, man.
I love that Dondi one. I love that Dondi one.
Yeah, this one's incredible, man.
This is the most recent series of paintings I did for a show I did in Paris and in Toronto and in Amsterdam. But these pretty much are sold out now. But I wanted to switch the camera, the lens, I want to put the light onto the actual graffiti artist, not the characters. So making Dondi into a Bodē lizard, doing a Dondi on the train done by Vaughn Bodē, was doing a tribute to the Dondi comic strip in the newspaper.
You're breaking the fourth,
like a layer of a
sixth wall there, you know what I mean?
It's like a layer of a cake. It just keeps getting deeper and deeper. But Dondi would love this.
No doubt.
He was the first graffiti artist to reach out to me when I was still just a comic book artist. And
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Dondi knew that my mother-in-law had a bodega in Brooklyn, and he sought us out. And he kept coming to the bodega saying, "When's Mark coming? When's Mark coming?" And she goes, "He'd be here next month, for Christmas or whatever." And so he finally showed up when I was there, and he never talked about graffiti. He never talked about anything like that. We drew for each other in my mother-in-law's living room, and he just wanted to know stories about what it was like growing up with Vaughn. And we didn't talk. I wish he had said, "Come bomb a train with me," because I was ripe for that. I was in my early 20s. I could have easily gone out
Oh
with him,
my God.
but
Yeah, that would have
he
been
didn't.
nice.
He
Can you
was too
imagine,
humble.
Maddie?
Oh,
He
mate.
was too humble a guy, to say that to me. He just wanted to show his respects and kind of, get some kind of blessing. There he is. Yeah,
Yeah, no
get some
doubt.
blessing from the family because he was so influenced by Bodhi himself.
Do you think there might have been a little bit of, again, I'm speculating here massively, but maybe because of this is the early times of graffiti when it was still such a phenomenon, early phenomenon that like maybe Dondi even felt like the reason why he didn't bring up the whole graph side of things or bringing you out on a mission, he probably wouldn't have even conceived to him that you would have been up for it. Because it was such an underground thing at the time, you know, and illegal. Maybe, I mean, I don't know.
It's true. He might have, because I was, like I said, I was just doing comics. I was working for Epic Illustrated and Heavy Metal. I was just happy to be following in my father's footsteps and holding my own. That was just thrilling for me, just alone. But to, it'd probably be like somebody, "Hey, let's go get arrested down in the yard." you could have gone that way,
It's true. Yeah, I mean,
And
definitely.
I
But
was
I'm sure now you get offers all the
like,
time. If you go to a new city, I bet there's graffiti writers hitting you up left, right, and center, going, "Come paint this wall, come paint this wall." Or is it not like that?
But nothing
Oh,
like it
yeah.
would have been with a Dondi whole car
Oh,
with
mate.
real Bodhi characters on the
Oh,
outside. I mean,
man.
that would have been.
I would have
Imagine
done
if that
it.
was one of the famous photos of graffiti. That would be huge.
I would have done it, really would have, if he'd just mentioned it. But I had no idea what that scene was back in the early 80s. I was like, I knew all these comic book people, and I grew up around, people like Frank Frazetta and Bernie Wrightson and Jeff Jones and all the Larry Todd, all these classic comic artists and
Yeah.
illustrators. And those were my, that's where I came from. So I wasn't hip to the graffiti till about 85, 84, 85. And I just happened, the first piece I ever did was ended up in Spraycan Art, just out of luck or fate. I was struggling with the can. I was like painting with a club or something. I didn't know to let the pressure out. I didn't know the different caps, but I had some good teachers around me, and I made this piece on a couple of doors, and it ended up in spray
In
can art.
spray can art. Yeah,
Yeah.
did you send a picture of that or no? I don't think.
Didn't,
No,
but
I'll
we
find
can
it.
dig it out. We can dig it
I'll
out.
put it
Yeah.
in
But
the yeah. I'll put it in the edit.
yeah, I you know what? My friend, because it ended up in the book, my friend at the warehouse, he saved the doors.
Oh wow.
And he years later he goes, "I got those fucking doors, they weigh a ton. You wanna fucking buy them back?" It's like, well, yeah.
Yeah, of
Just
course.
give me $300 for all my fucking problems.
Jesus. So you got them now then? What, you
I
got them
got them.
still?
They're in my
Ah.
bathroom downstairs. Like, so I,
Wow.
Prigoff, Jim Prigoff.
Wait, so those doors, they were your first piece that you put
Yeah.
up with spray paint, and they got into spray can art on your first piece.
And I
and you've got the doors. Yeah.
The doors.
Holy shit.
Jesus.
So anyway, Jim Prigoff said that I have the only thing from the whole book that still exists.
Wow.
And so
what kind of condition is it in? What kind of condition is condition. The doors and the pieces?
It's been scratched up and you know, originally it was topless, but one of the women that lived in the warehouse got offended. And I sprayed a top on her, and unfortunately, it was a day later that Jim Prigoff showed up and says, "Will you pose in front of that?" So it wasn't the way it originally was, but I do have a photo of it somewhere. But
amazing.
But yeah, I was just lucky, man. Like,
that's crazy.
Not bad for your first ever piece. The first magazine you get into, Spraycan Art. That's it.
Yeah. I owe that to Pops, you know, but his influence. But I'm always working on some project, you know, some long-term projects. Cobalt 60 is still like my main drive in comics. I'm working on an 86 page story right now.
Incredible.
About the Cobalt 60.
Yeah, inspired by Zack Snyder, who he's the director of, you know, Watchmen and Batman and Superman, and he's you know, Justice League.
He's huge.
Yeah,
he's...
Zach is a big Cobalt 60 fan, and he actually gave me the option money about 10 years ago.
Damn, okay.
Conversion, but he got sucked up into superhero land, and I haven't heard back. But now and then they. I'm still on the list because they called to make sure all our contacts are current. So we still have that, you know. Wow. Maybe one day Cobalt 60 will be a movie. Who knows?
Right, yo, that would be incredible, man. Jeez, it might. Oh, live action movie. Oh shit.
Yeah, live action with CGI. Yeah.
Damn, that would be next level, man. I'll tell you what, we usually listen to music on this podcast, and we've got a few suggestions from Mark, but I just want to start off with the Beastie Boys Sure Shot, you get a massive shout out in that one, man. So let's just listen to a bit of this track, and then maybe we can talk about it. I know you know Ad Rock, right? You mentioned that to me.
Yeah, we hung out a few times. Yeah.
Let's listen to it and then go from there, man. The Large Professor remix is pretty dope.
You can't, and you don't stop, because you can't, and you don't stop, or when you can't, and you don't stop.
Like, okay, so Beastie Boys, you mentioned Jack Snyder. Them, what other kind of celebs maybe have reached out or have shown that they're into the artwork? I mean, any come off the top of the head now?
I mean, animation, you know, animators. Well, there's Ralph Bakshi. who, you know, did Wizards, and that was kind of my father. He wanted to do a movie with my father,
Wow,
and
okay.
my father didn't want to work with him after he did some shady business with Robert Crumb over Fritz the Cat. So my father said, "Over my dead body, are we working together?" And then
Damn.
when my dad died, back she went right to Wizards and started making the movie Wizards. And so you might see some similarities there.
Oh shit.
And he never paid my mom. He never paid my mom anything, you know, which he could have, like, we were so broke at the time when my dad died that he could have thrown her a couple $1,000, you know. My father wanted six figures, but, and that's a lot of money back then. But, you know, we were so broke, he could have got a license for nothing, you know, really. But he chose another path. But anyway, and then I met John Lasseter. A friend of mine was, you know, when he was working at ILM with George Lucas, he was working on the first, you know, Pixar
Wow.
movie, Andre and Wallaby. And it was this multi-million dollar little, you know, 1 minute clip at the time. And I came into the ILM studios and he showed me around Pixar. It was just a little company at that time. And he took me into his studio and he points up on the top shelf and I got all your dad's books, Mark.
Yeah.
And the John Lasseter, the creator, one of the creators of Pixar, was a big Bodē fan.
Wowzers,
Matt
nice.
Groening is a big Bodē fan. I met him once. It was unfortunate. We met at San Diego Comic-Con in like the 80s, or no, maybe, yeah, late 80s maybe.
Bruh, Matt Groening, so the Simpsons is
Yeah, the
partly
Simpsons.
inspired, you know?
Well, he came up to me and he goes, "Mark, you should be doing animation with your, you know,
Yeah.
with the Bodē stuff, definitely. I'll come over to the table, we'll talk." And he did. He came over to the Bodē table where I was sitting, and Matt Groening shows up and he starts to look at stuff, and all of a sudden he was
Yeah, swarmed, I
just
bet.
swarmed by, I don't know, dozens of people who just like, "Matt, Matt, Matt, Matt."
Did
And he's
they
like,
all
"Mark,
look like did they look like
Mark, Mark." It's
the
like that. And I was like, "Oh man,
Yo, did they all look like the comic book guy from
it could have
Simpsons?
changed my life, that one little conversation, you know." But it
Jeez.
didn't happen because he was just like, "Wow, I really
Oh
like,
shit.
oh."
Yeah, drawn away.
Like the fans, you know, took away that one moment we had. But
Crazy.
yeah, you know, like he's influenced
What
so
about
many.
Ad Rock from Beastie Boys? I mean, you said you're quite would you say you're close friends, or I mean, I don't know, like
No,
no.
we're in passing, you know, like when they came out with that, the clip that you just played, when they came out with that, I was good with it. I heard it on the radio and I was all good with it. And then I saw the video and the video had a Cheech Wizard in it.
Yeah.
And I was like, "Hey, wait a minute. That's ours." You know, you know, and so my wife looked up the manager and I got in touch with the manager and said, "Look, we're, you know, we could sue you at this point for, you know, not getting the
Gonna
rights,
sue your ass.
permission to use Cheech Wizard in the video." And then Ad Rock called me like the next day, and he was like, "Oh man, we make so much money off all the t-shirts and stuff we do for the Beastie Boys. Just do us some Bodē Beastie Boys collabs and we'll give you a six-figure check and it'll all be good." And I was like, "Oh, all right." And then I did a bunch of drawings and then nothing. And then Dr. Revolt calls me, goes, yo, I'm over at Madison Square Garden with the Beastie Boys, man. They got your drawings as backstage passes." And I'm like,
Oh,
really?
for
So
fuck's
they
sake.
just did a really, they did, you know, I guess they're
Yeah.
just I don't think they did it intentionally or with bad intention. I think they're just like cultural vampires, and they're just part of
No,
it.
it's really mad, like, because you can tell that they fucking love it. You know what I mean? It's not coming from a let's abuse this and take the piss out. You know what I mean? Like, you can tell they genuinely love it, man. And but the thing is, it's such a tricky line because, like you said earlier, man, if you let things slide a lot enough, it just avalanches, and then you find yourself just with nothing. You know what I'm saying? And also in graffiti now, there's a big it happens every couple of years, like a big brand will use a famous graffiti writer's work that was done illegally, and then they think they can get away with it. When then they go, and then the artist will come up, and then there'll be a big lawsuit, and usually the artist wins, which is good stuff, you know. But yeah, you gotta just be careful, man.
Well, there is a gray line there. I mean, Bodie is in all those photographs and all those trains and all those murals and all those, pieces and sketchbooks and all of that stuff's being documented and published. But I own the characters. I own them. I should be getting like a sign off. At least. Because, but there's this gray area where if you take a photo of something, then you own the photo. So that puts it into another, there's another layer, and so it's not misappropriation. It's like document, I took this photograph and then now the photograph belongs to me. That's where the gray area is
And
with.
then similarly to what I said before about sampling in hip hop, it's like, okay, they took the Johnny Coltrane loop, but they've, rejigged it and put a drum loop over it or whatever. And now that they own they produced the track, but it's still using imagery from, or I mean, music from something else. And it is a gray line. You're right. Like there's that reaches a point where you're like, okay, now you're taking a piss. Now you start owing me
Yeah,
money
but
or
like I
whatever.
said, I love the graffiti world.
Well,
I embraced it. I embraced it myself. Now
what
I paint all over.
I was going to say as well, like with the sampling aspect, it's like a lot of these artists would have been forgotten about, and if they hadn't been sampled by these 90s hip hop guys, like they were sampling some pretty obscure stuff that people, they still have a career now because of those samples used. They might not have paid for the
For
samples,
sure.
but so again, there's that side of things as well, which makes it even more complicated,
Absolutely.
But Mark, I know you've got a hard out. It's the Super Bowl today or something. I know you're not a sports guy, but you said you were invited to a party, and you said I'm a party guy. You know me.
Super Bowl Sunday.
Yeah, like people say, oh, what team are you into? It's like lingerie football.
Lingerie
I
football. Yes.
like, that's
Well,
them.
I tell
What
you
team do
what.
you like in lingerie football? Because, and I'm like, that's entertainment to me. It's like watching girls all, tackling each other and stuff and lingerie. You gotta love it, But no, I've done sports things over the years. And I always say, don't talk too much, Mark, when you're talking to the people who are paying you to do the sports stuff,
Yeah.
don't talk too much.
Well,
Because I
listen.
don't know anything.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, before you go, I would, because another thing that we do here on Arms House to Your Mom's House is people send in their artwork and we critique their graph. Usually it's graffiti, either a sketch or a piece or whatever done wherever. And I usually tell the people, don't send it in unless you have thick skin. All right, because we don't hold back, and obviously we're not here to discourage anybody or tell anybody to stop or anything like that. We're just kind of, we're not going to say it's good if we don't think it's good. You know what I mean?
Well, we noticed that that like when you say something, post something on the negative side, that gets more reactions from the general public, and that's a proven fact.
Yeah, no, of course that is,
Proven
and we know,
fact.
yeah, we noticed
And
that
like
with a fact of the internet.
I'll post an unpublished Vaughn Bodē sketch. No one's ever seen before. I'll post it on the Vaughn Bodē World of Vaughn Bodē site, and I'll get like
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, that's cool. Like,
and then you post like, I hate what they're doing to the lizard.
yeah, exactly.
And all of a sudden, there's like 80 comments and like you know 500 likes. You know,
but yeah.
Same thing, you know, like some guy got a cheat wizard tattoo on his neck, and then a friend that, you know, like one of his boys said, oh, that looks like a dick.
Yeah. I got it here somewhere.
The guy was crushed, you know. It's like, I got a dick on my neck. I was like, that doesn't look like a dick.
Yeah.
I got a dick on my neck.
So you
but
didn't
he's, do, he's you, ready you, to jump off a bridge, you know. So
But you didn't do that tattoo then. It wasn't
no,
you.
I didn't.
No, okay. All right. Okay. Cause then he wrote this long comment saying, look.
No, that's his comments.
Yeah, that's like, his comment.
This is brilliant. This is brilliant.
Like, you got a dick on my neck, you fucker.
Yeah.
I don't think this is funny. You put a dick on my neck.
You guys can read it. It's there on the screen. It's fucking hilarious.
I've never seen
and then
that. I've
and
never
then you and then Mark, you sent me this, which is actually the Cheech Wizard taking the hat off, and it's a fucking beast.
My father, that's not approved by my father. We had some beers, and I was like, I wonder if Cheech Wizard could just be a giant dick under a hat.
So this isn't canon,
dick with
though.
A dick, you know. Yeah. But, this is all, you know, there's a disclaimer at the bottom that it's not a but
man, that is hilarious.
But anyway, if this guy had seen this, he would have jumped off a fucking bridge.
Fucking hell. But again, back to like
what I did to deserve you drawing a dick on my neck. That's a great way to open the comment. He's absolutely fuming.
It's hilarious, man. But yo, Mark, you're a big tattoo artist at the moment as well, and we haven't even mentioned that.
I did it for 25 years. I stopped in 2019. I had a tap on the shoulder. I always, you know, I just had a tap on the shoulder. It's like, Mark, you know, return to what we're known for. Okay. You know, I listen. I believe it's my father telling me, get back to our work, you know, get back to the work. And I love tattooing, and I loved the person, Karen Rose, that I was working for in Berkeley, but I just it was time to get back to the comics and the paintings and perpetuate the characters, because we're not going to be around forever, and I want to do as much as possible to continue the characters so they have a long life, you know.
So that makes my tattoo even more.
I knew you were going to say that. I knew you were going to say
that. It makes me. You Mark,
I remember
this,
that.
Yeah, you did this. I remember I asked you to put a fez on the head because I'm Arabic.
I remember you being a bitch. Yeah.
Yes, I was a friend. Yes, I was.
Maddie told me that that's true.
I almost.
I
remember
him yesterday, and he said,
"Like, get the fuck out of here."
Yeah,
no.
Quit crying.
This is what happened. I've always. This is the only tattoo I have.
I got it on the inside of my bicep. Yeah, that's the most painful place where you can get it. That's why.
Yeah. I got one in my mom.
Well, I mean, like, I remember seeing that you were coming to London, you were tattooing in Camden. I can't remember the place. What was it? Needle by the Needle? Something?
Evil from the Needle.
Evil from the Needle. And yeah. I was like, quickly, I'll just book 2 hours. I was like, I don't know what I want to get. As long as it's Mark who does it and he does a character, characters, I'm good. You know what I mean? And you freestyled it on the spot. I just told you, look, I just want a fez on it. And I wanted the hands to do like that Dondi. Yeah, exactly.
Dondi pose, yeah.
And so you did that for me, literally. And I was supposed to be there for 2 hours to get it in color, but I was such a bitch that I was with my mate Frez, and I was like, bro, let's just keep it black and white. And the second hour,
I can't do it.
You could do another one for my mate. But no, I remember, because I don't know if you remember next to us was a woman with two guys on him, tattooing her whole back. And she was just sitting there going, like, looking at me. And I was just there going, oh. And then Mark was like,
can handle pain much better than that.
Oh, yeah. 100%. Definitely more than me, man. I'm a pussy. But I remember you saying, like, yo, like, stop breathing like that. You're going to pass out, bruv. You know? I was like, oh, shit, man. I was like, just fucking end it now, man. End it, man. And, yeah.
But I
cherish it, man. I cherish this tattoo.
So many people passed out, especially back east when I was learning how to tattoo. Just the energy... People are more highly strung, like there's the energy is more intense on the East Coast. And so people just pass out on the reg, you know, all the time.
I bet.
I mean, I had a guy that he was a big football player. He was huge. And he went a little ducky. It was like a fraternal thing, you know, on his thigh. And I was like, sure, you want that on your thigh, huh? It's a paternal thing for my college football team. And I was like, okay. And it took 2 minutes, and all of a sudden he goes, I don't feel so good. And I grabbed his shoulders, but he was so big.
Jeez.
Just like a tree coming down. And he took me and my tattoo equipment and everything all on top of him.
Oh,
on
the shit. Floor.
He's like, oh. And all the other artists in the shop were laughing. They were like, ah, Bodē, look at Bodē. And like, I'm on top of this guy, you know, and he's like, oh, man.
Jesus Christ. But okay, back to what we like to do here.
I'm
on the
I'm not in a hurry, so if you want to just edit some of this and just take the best stuff, that's fine.
For sure, man. I mean, I kind of like to leave it kind of loose and casual. Our listeners and people who watch, they kind of like it, like, you know, casual vibes, you know. But yeah, I'll cut out all the, you know, bullshit stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not in a hurry. It's still kind of early. I mean, we could cover some other stuff if you want.
Beautiful, beautiful. But right now we're going to get into some critique.
This is what we're going to do.
We're going to start with the UK. So these are all Bodē characters done by artists in the UK. Some from the 80s, some from the 90s, some done just the other day.
I hate it.
Well,
that's what I'm saying.
Don't be scared.
You're allowed to say whatever you want.
Like I said, you know, we're not here to discourage people, but we just want to, you know, we got himself here. So, you know what I mean? Let's let's get into this. So this is by
Bodē says you're shit.
This is a good one. Here we go.
Yeah, man.
He's done it proud here.
The screws from Sunpot. Yeah. I love that character.
Yeah, man. It's been done quite a lot.
I'm not gonna diss anybody, man. I know better.
No dissing, but like,
I'm
maybe
fine. I'm fine. I mean, Okay. Everybody has their different styles. I, you know, their own personal hand's gonna come into it. I don't, you know.
Of course.
Oh, that one. That guy.
Yeah.
He's shit. This guy. What?
This is a guy, a dick.
It looks like a dick. So this is like my take from, you know, the film La Haine, the French movie La Haine. There's three main characters, and Saïd is one of them, and he wears this jacket and stuff, and the Bays La Police. So I did my little rendition of like Bodē crossed over. This is ill. This is one of the best you've seen. Okay, moving on. Next. What do you think about those mashups people do? That happens a lot when people blend Bodē characters into like another famous thing from pop culture. I know you've done it even a couple times.
Oh man, yeah, for sure. That's natural progression of the work. I mean, you gotta put your twist on it.
Exactly.
You know, like Banzai. Dave Banzai.
Oh yeah, I've got one of his. Oh no, not Bonzai.
Dave Banzai was he stood out. You know, he did the big goggles on the characters and put the, you know, the B-boy stuff on them.
I got this one by Chio. Chio is incredible, man.
Chio's up there, man. He's my boy. We go out drinking when I'm out in the UK.
I know you've done some collabs with him, right?
Yeah, this is
nice. A lot of drinking. Yep.
A lot of drinking, no doubt. This one's incredible.
We collaborated on a few beers, I think. Yeah, he's great. I love Chio. He's one of the few that I would, if he lived over here, I'd be employing him left and right.
Wow.
Because he has a really good comic style and he has good flair, you know.
And you can tell it's a Chio just off the bat. You don't even have to look at the tag on the spray can. Well, you know it's a Chio.
All the styles come out, you know.
Yeah.
I mean,
no doubt. Here's another one. I can't remember who did this one. Okay, it's a little bit, you know, a little bit squashed in the head there, but he's put his own flair. I like the little shading on it as well, and you know, yeah, he's put his own little twist to it with the little hat. I like this, and the Christmas.
It's like that's the London Cockney hat, isn't it? Flat cap,
and
what you got me for Quimbo?
Yeah, exactly. And about a kick in the bells. I like that.
Kicking the bells. Yeah.
I'm fine with that stuff. I don't know if my dad would dig it, but it just, you know, just because of the fringe on the hat. I mean, you know, like he didn't really like that part of it. Like later on, I started like, you know, putting shoes on the hat or putting a hat on the hat.
Yeah.
Or, you know, like, and now people got a face coming out from under the hat.
Oh my God.
You know, it just keeps morphing into different characters, which is great. I never, you know, I like seeing the different takes, you know, like it's endless.
Oh, this is another one of mine with the fez, obviously. It put the little fez on there. I'm not being too self-indulgent, but, you know, I just wanted to.
Always with the flex. Fez. Oh, yeah. Always with the fez.
Alice. All right, this is an old school train from
that's nice.
Mid-80s. Dream with the old Cheech Wizard with a couple of drips in there and dots and bubbles. Is there a rule for the stars on the hat? Like there's only a certain number of stars?
Yeah. This is basically, there's a pattern. My father made a sculpture downstairs. I have it in my studio that he kept by his drawing table. And it has the exact star pattern.
Okay.
This isn't completely accurate, as they were probably bigger in the original, like more like.
Oh, on your T-shirt. Yeah, there we go.
So they're a little bit bigger, but the stars are in the right position.
So it's like three big red stars and two blue black stars. Two little black stars.
More than five or something. Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, like anyway. All right, let's move on from this. This is another famous graffiti writer here. Fame on a train here with two of the lizards here. There we go. That's quite deep on a train as well.
It's not bad for stolen paint as well, you know.
Yeah.
Painting a shitty black over the green of the lizard when you're trying to do the shadow.
Yeah.
I believe he might have taken that from, I'm trying to guess where he got the character from, but there's this strip called Sex Talk where my dad is explaining sex.
Okay. Yeah,
the older lizard to the younger lizard.
Yeah, that might be it, man. Yeah.
Explaining, you know, like how to get the girls and what to do with them. And he's like, and that was our relationship. I mean, my dad was always trying to hook me up when I was little. Like, have you got laid yet, son? And I was like, no, do I have to take my pants off for that one?
Here's a cool one. Oh. Talk about a little mashup. Okay. We got a Deadpool lizard here.
Yeah. Yeah, I actually did a few of those and then it caught on pretty quick.
Ah, okay. All right. I
did a Deadpool Cheech Wizard. I don't think I did a lizard though. This guy mashed it up in a different direction. That's cool. Yeah, old school Deadpool.
But again, it's that same pose though, the one that I got mad at, man.
But
he's done the.
But isn't that the pose on your tattoo?
You got it.
I got the pose of like his foot up in the air, like he's walking towards you. Anyway, this is a writer, West London Bees. He loves your characters. He puts them on everything. These ones, it's like a slightly. Froggy.
I think those are the Peeper Brothers, but I could be wrong.
Oh, no, you might be right, man. I might be getting confused, man.
Peeper brothers were frogs, you know, the little brothers, and get into trouble and stuff.
Okay, all right, here we go. Another one here. I'm not sure who sent this one
Ready for
in.
the
I might
time
be
distortion.
Ingo. Sorry, yeah, go for it. What?
The time distortion trick. He's getting ready for the kick in the balls there.
Oh, yeah,
The
exactly.
wind up.
Now, big up. It's you know, it's
I
crisp,
like the
nice,
head and face of this one.
like
Yeah,
the
this
little
one reminds me more
fades.
of the comic.
Yeah.
The eyes done well.
Oh yeah, how come sometimes you get the dick in there, sometimes there's no dick? Is it just to keep it PG, I'm assuming?
Well, that had them. They didn't have sexual organs through the 60s, and then in about 71 or 72, suddenly they had a dick.
Of course they did.
And they started, they had a pud, and so that's where it came in, you know. Like before that, they, you know, they had no sexual organs,
Okay.
and
Yeah.
then
Was that
they
to make it more adult? Because obviously the comics were aimed more towards adults, or was it they more aimed towards the
how comes
children?
what he's trying to say is how comes all of the ladies are those big booty Latinas looking sexy? Every single one of them is always the same. Tiny little panties, massive little ass. It's
Yeah.
they're the sexy Latinas with the curly hair.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Those were like, trying to look for samples, but
He's got
sorry, I've got some.
he got samples. He
I
got
got samples of the
samples.
ladies, but let's keep on track with these. There's look, this guy's done the Cheech Wizard, but he put a beanie hat on it. This is Obi sent this in.
Ah, nice.
Yeah,
See,
you in?
I mean, it's almost unrecognizable. I mean, it's gone
Yeah,
in
it's
a.
unrecognizable, Obi.
No,
No Steve.
I'm not. It's not a
It's
disc.
unrecognizable. No Steve's Obies.
See, that's the bite right there. That'll be.
Yeah.
I'd be like, "Fuck it, man! I hate Bodie."
He hasn't
That's so good. That's.
he hasn't
No,
quite
I just.
got the underneath of the
What are you
foot.
doing to my legacy?
That's what we want, Mark. Come on, like I said, I'm gonna make a clip of this and then it's gonna go
No,
viral. No, I won't.
that's
Of
okay.
course, I won't, man. I might clip this entire bit, obviously within context. I won't, you know, make you look
Anyway, move on
bad.
to the next one, Maddie. There
Oh
we
yeah,
go.
this is
Look, Queen Lizzie.
another one of
Have
mine.
some respect, Queen Lizzie.
Check the
You should have
boom.
put the fez. There she is. See what I'm saying?
Yeah, I'm hypnotized now by the
You're getting sleepy.
So I did this one after Queen Elizabeth
Ah,
passed
sweet.
away, you know,
You
and I
should have put
remember
a fez. You should have put a fez on it.
I tried to keep it more regal, you
Queen, I
know.
remember that one. Yeah.
I think you commented on it when I posted it. I
I think
think I
it's a little
tagged you.
soon, man.
It was a bit soon because obviously it's playing on the whole, you know, lizard people everywhere, you know,
Yeah.
the queen and the royal family lizard. So I thought that I don't know
I
why
don't
it just
think,
came to me. No,
I
obviously
don't,
not.
no harm done, but yeah, it was a bit, I mean, it was like
Right
the next day.
after, yeah, it was.
They jumped on that.
It was all right. This
Queen
one,
Lizzie. Yo, what's this? Who's this?
this is by C's, another big writer here in London, but it's a really shitty photo. You can
It's
just about
old.
make out the lizard there, but yeah, I just included
Right.
that one.
Nice. On trains in London, Mark, man. This is all you.
Isn't it
That was a
crazy?
train.
This is a big writer, originally from Kent, I think, man. Score. TRC legendary writer. Here we go with these ones. They're a bit rough around the edges, but you know the paint back then wasn't great. You know you
But
can see the
how old are
patching.
these? You're not talking about them at all. When did this is like 90, 80 what? 89 or something? 88?
I don't have the dates, man, but it's definitely in the 80s, maybe early 90s, but
Yeah, it looks like early 90s to me,
it could
but
be. Yeah, it could be. But yeah, that's a dope one though as well. I think that's it for the UK, and now I got some more of the classic ones and not so classic.
Oh,
Oh, there we
yeah.
go.
Well, that's taken from a drawing I did for Topps trading cards for the Garbage Pail Kids.
Ah, oh, sick. Yeah, amazing.
I
And
did.
that's the obviously Clockwork Orange, right?
Yeah,
The
they did. They
droog.
Clark. Yeah, it was Clark Work Orange or something in it.
Clockwork.
They didn't accept my first drawing, which which had the alien invasion, and it had Trump as a garbage pail kid.
Oh shit!
And he's like crashing over the wall, and you know, it was like they were like, no.
Wow.
This is my second choice.
Okay. Also, another thing I've noticed, the difference between your drawings of the characters and your father, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, your ones get slightly more chunkier. Yeah. That's one,
I see that.
I think your dad did them a little bit more on the slender side, I think, maybe. But anyway.
Yeah, he often squashed and stretched, you know, in different ways. He was always experimenting with different ways to draw the characters. You know, it really was universal. He was an expanding universe. He was always experimenting with the boundaries that he was, you know, he
and
put
you
on
can
himself.
And you can see that because you post, obviously, I'll put all the links to Mark's social media and stuff like that below. Definitely go link that up and follow him and support. Because you often post a lot of
Check
the old
Check
sketches and from your dad's sketchbooks and stuff, like where he's experimenting with things. And you can see how wild he was getting there, you know, which is super interesting.
They're working on Nick Francis is a director. And he's doing a documentary on my father for the last 4 years, and got like hundreds of hours of interviews from. He's trying to get as many interviews as possible from my father's generation, as a lot of them are passing, and you know, they're all in their 80s. And
I can't believe that hasn't been done before, man. It's crazy.
Well,
yeah,
got close a few times, and I turned them down. One director wanted to go hard on my father's sexual side of his person, and I said, well, that was part of him, but it really is not
not the
that.
Be all end all. Yeah, of course.
And then the other one wanted to say he's the king of graffiti characters, we want to do a graffiti thing, and I'm like, my father didn't know about graffiti. I turned that one down, you know, because it just was coming in from the wrong angle. And finally, Nick Francis came in and he goes, your dad was a creative dynamo. I want to feature that. You know, I want to touch on all the different aspects of his life and, you know, the cross-dressing and the whole thing, but only as a side thing. And I said, can I get a happy ending where the characters live on through me? And he goes, absolutely. And I was like, here, you got it, you know? And so, you know.
Okay, cool.
So
We look forward to that one, man.
Here's another. Well, documentaries don't happen overnight.
No, of course, yeah.
Well, we got some great interviews. Great, great, great interviews.
And like you said, it's imperative to do it now quickly while they can. You know what I mean? So I'm glad to hear that that's happening, man.
Yeah, one of the interviews was George DiCaprio was a good friend of my dad's. He's Leonardo DiCaprio's father.
Oh shit! Okay.
He was a comic book artist, underground comic book artist, and a distributor, publisher.
I never knew that.
Around that time, and anyway, he had a story that David Bowie got my father arrested. Got him arrested, and my father was going to work with him and talk to the manager. Said after the Ziggy Stardust show is over, David will meet you at the hotel room. And my dad
Where, in England or America?
This was in LA.
LA.
And so my father, wanting to make a first impression, gets a foldable pyramid that's made out of wood, brings it into the lobby, sets it up, and then, you know, he's dressed with his long hair just like this.
Yeah, looks like he's in Led Zeppelin.
Meditating in the lobby, and he's waiting for David to show up.
Wow.
David comes in the back door of the lobby, goes up to his room, does a bunch of blow, gets so paranoid he calls the cops and says, somebody's trying to kill me.
Oh,
and,
shit.
And the cops come in, you know, like storm into the lobby, and they're like, who's there, David
Bowie?
The guy under the pyramid's like, I am. You're arrested, motherfucker. It was a fellow cheek wizard moment, you know, like, please, please.
Fucking brilliant. Brilliant. Nobody knew that.
So my dad said, I almost got to meet him. And George DiCaprio bailed my dad out a few hours later.
Whoa, man.
What a story, huh?
Insane, man. Insane.
But could you imagine if those two got together? I mean,
oh, mate.
Major Tom, you know, being a flip book illustrated by my father.
Wow. That would have been so incredible, man. But instead, we're stuck with this shitty rendition of of your fucking lizard character. Now, I'm only kidding.
Is this you again?
No, this ain't me. This is some other motherfucker. I don't know who that is. I can't remember who said that in, but no, it's a bit rough around the edges, obviously, but you know, whatever, it does the job, I guess. This one's pretty awesome. Cool.
That almost looks like, you know, it's starting like the influencers. It's like I could see a little Chio in there, you know, like,
yeah,
but it's not Chio, it's some, you know, it's the next another somebody's style being mixed into that from that, you know. It's just like it's like ripples out, you know. It's like a rippling effect.
Oh man, it must be so
across the planet. It must be
so surreal and amazing to see it, man. You know, I really like this one.
I'd be like on a train going from Barcelona to Cadaqués. We were going to Cadaqués, and which is where Dali and Picasso and Disney had their summer homes. And I'm on a train, and there's like nothing but farm yards and, you know, and cows and shit. And there's a whole broken down silo or something that looks like it collapsed. There's a Bodē broad.
Damn.
And I couldn't get a picture because it was like, what? Oh, shit.
Yeah, you know? Yeah.
But it was like a hello. You know, it's like I was out in the middle of nowhere where I'd never been before. And all of a sudden there was like a, hey, son, you know,
actually, don't worry.
I think I'm
hey, Bodies. Bodies are out here too.
I missed out this one. This is one of the biggest graffiti writers in London is 10 foot
in the world.
Yeah, for sure. And this is his throw up that he does real quick, and it's fucking everywhere, man. And obviously he's got the little, you know, the Bodē kind of lizard head there.
You know, that's very rare because, you know, like a lot of the quick taggers don't, if they put a character, it's very, very simple. But this is a nice way to work it in.
Yeah, man. Because it's like a one and a zero.
Bodē says 10 foot's nice.
Yes, 10 foot.
You know, I know that there's a lot of hate for Banksy, but Banksy did
a
cow. He painted a cow with a Bodē lizard on it.
Oh, yeah. Mm. And it says wild style on it or something. And then the other one had a Bodē lizard. Yeah, I think I remember that.
And actually, like, I posted that in the 90s. I posted that on my website. And I got this email. He goes, yo, this is so-and-so. I'm a writer in Bristol. I'm glad you like my cow that I painted the lizard on, you know.
Wow.
That was before he was really famous or anything. But that was Banksy, like, emailing me for like a nod from using his cow, you know, with a lizard on it. Whenever I post that shit, he gets so much, I don't know.
Well, there's a lot of animosity, obviously, between the graffiti writers and street artists in general, you know, and Banksy's kind of like the spearhead of street art. So everyone just kind of guns for him, man. And obviously the Robbo, I don't know if you know about the Robbo.
Yes, I did know about that. Yeah.
So
there was some problem there too. So.
Yeah. So, you know,
I try not to get caught up in the politics of, you know, I'm just having a good time, you know, like, exactly. You know? Exactly. I just want Payton to have a good time, man, and go to the pub, you know.
What did that last one say, Maddie? Genocide.
It says genocide. Oh, man, I can't remember who this is by. It's by a big writer from back in the day with two, obviously, classic Bodies on there, man.
Yeah.
They're a bit, again, a little bit rough, but on a train, you know, Looks
in
sick,
the yard,
no?
done with a
You know
bit
what
of
it looks
paint.
like? It looks like, you know, they did it in their sketchbook and then they took the sketchbook to the train. They didn't go straight off the comic, you know, like Dondi was going straight off the comic, but his renditions weren't the best either, but he was one of the ones who really made it famous, you know.
Yeah, man. Here we go. This is a acid with a
Awesome.
yeah, that's the ill one. This is another one from back in the day. Big up Sprog3 on Instagram. He's got lots of old
Yeah,
school tricks
see,
on
that's
there.
what you're talking about. Like when you take the characters and you do your own thing, you know. Like I can't even place
It
that
might be a
ring.
mix between one of the Bodie Broads and the
Yeah,
Lizard, and I don't know what's
mix.
going on there. Yeah, it's pretty cool.
That's what you do, you know. When you're an artist, you just, you know, continue, you
That's
know.
all I was asking people to do in that little video that, you know, that got so
Yeah.
many people riled up, you know.
Well,
They
yeah, I think, you know, the bite, the clip.
again, that's the same.
Oh,
I mean, this
yeah.
is kind of a cool the like a balloon, like blown up balloons. That's kind of trendy nowadays to do, but it's pretty cool with
Yeah, that's
the
in Stockholm. Like when we did a tribute to my dad, in Stockholm at Snöstatra is the only place where graffiti can be done legally. Everywhere else, it's like you get thrown in jail. So still haven't quite opened the doors there. But we did it. About 50, 60 artists got together a few years ago, and they all and. This was huge, his piece. I was just a couple down from him.
I don't think I've got that one though.
No, that's okay.
Apologies.
No, it's
Here we go. I just labeled this photo boobs for this
yeah.
lady here at the end. It's a little bit wonky. I don't know. She's not as pretty as when you and your dad draw them. She's got a bit of a
No,
wonky eye there,
buzz,
but
mate,
the
buzz.
first thing my father taught me when I was a kid, I was 7 years old. For some reason, that was the magic age. He goes, "Son, this is how you draw tips." And he
Sick.
goes, "Here's a pencil, you know, follow along.
Mm.
And this is how you draw tits. And if you draw them just like this, you'll always make money." And I wish I had that sketch because I'd frame it in gold.
Oh man.
That was like the most valuable lesson that I've ever had for
And I tell
me.
you, titties make money.
and also titties are difficult to draw, man, because they got a certain weight. Obviously, they come in all different shapes and sizes, but these ones in this picture here that we're looking at, they look like fake, you know, like silicone implant type titties. You know, them ones that just stick out like
Well, this is
balloons.
from memory, obviously, you know.
Of course. I'm not being too
Good
harsh.
job. Did a good job for by memory, but
No doubt.
I went to in upstate New York. I went to some, you know, where I was a minority. I went to some rough schools, and I would get picked on constantly, and fucked with, and thrown shit at, and people paint on my clothes. It was nasty. It was
Oh,
bad
wow.
school. But you know what I did? I drew a naked girl. And went up to the biggest kid in the school and went, "This is for you." And he goes, "My man, Bodie,
Oh.
Bodie," you know, and like, and so I suddenly I had a bodyguard,
Yes.
and I could talk as much shit as I wanted, you know, like I could just like I had a big mouth and I was a little guy, I needed a big friend, you know,
Yeah.
and so whenever I went to a new school, I'd single out the biggest kid in the school. I mean, even in elementary school, I was like that because, like, you know, I was in third grade or something, and this kid named Nick Lazzaponi, this Italian kid, he's like
Nick Lazzy Pony.
Andre the Giant in third grade.
Oh, wow.
He'd take an apple and crush it with his one hand. And I was
Yeah.
like, "That's my friend. I'm gonna make him my friend."
You mess with me, you messing with my friends,
Oh,
yo.
little
Nick
crush your head
Lazzy
like
Pony.
a
Nick
poke
Lazzy
your head
Pony.
in the juice. And
Jesus.
so I always that was a very valuable lesson my father gave me is how to draw the women.
So
Yeah.
there we go. Boobs saved the day, man.
There
Here's
you go.
another classic as well, man, of the Bodie. on the New York City Metro
yeah.
line. That one's a really cool one. I like, you see, even here, the titties, even though they're cartoonish, but they kind of sit with a certain weight to them. You, if you know what, I know, Mark, you must know what I mean. You know, like, anyway.
We're talking about the weight of the titties.
Yeah. Actually, I was going to ask Mark, are you a titty man or an ass man?
You know what? I did the cartoon concert where I read the voices for the characters like my father used to do.
And yes.
I did one in the UK in the brewery district. There was a brewery, Truman, was it?
Yeah, Truman Brewery. Yeah,
that's Truman Brewery.
Brick Lane. Yeah, Brick Lane.
Brick Lane. And, and I did the cartoon concert there. 300 people showed up.
Oh, man.
And this, you know, obviously, like, for 3 hours, I signed whatever people put in front of me. And one person comes up to me and she goes, "You like big tits, don't you?" And I was like, "Well, actually, no. My father had me draw them like that. I really, no, I'm not into that." Yeah. And I could see steam shooting out her ears, like she was ready for a fight. And you know, and I was telling her I was a victim.
Yeah, yeah.
I was held down and to drama.
Actually, that's an interesting point. Have you been, you know, yeah, so that's like one example of maybe...
No, I mean, you know, I like, you know, I'm more of a butt-ass man myself.
Okay, okay, cool, man.
But, you know, I don't want to go on about that, but...
I don't discriminate, you know what I mean? It's all love, man.
Yeah.
Okay, we've seen this.
Yes, I'm more into the boutier of the... the bodaciousness.
No doubt, man. all right, here's another Cheech wizard sent in by somebody. I can't remember who. Oh, it's pretty good.
It's a dick.
It's a dick. It's a fucking dick.
You can't have the stars touching and so close like that.
I don't know what happened to this star here. This star went a bit weird here, man. And there's no black stars, but we'll let him off.
Blue.
You know, it looks like he took it right off. You know, like you could see the feet on, he must have the toy, I bet. And he was like,
oh, maybe, right, yeah,
trying to get that feeling on the legs there.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's Cal. Cal and Mare, they were brothers, and they were the ones that I saw on that train when it went by on 23rd Street when I first saw the first Bodē stuff.
Oh, wow.
We cannot find pictures. Os Gemos, who are like really big Bodē fans and they're good, like brothers to me. They were looking. They said, "Mark, we want to find this train. We look everywhere. We want to find this train that you saw, the very first Bodē train." And nobody can find it. And it's because there's no photos. You know, like Calfon and Martha were really...
Well, who were you saying? Were you saying it was Kelly's?
We're just starting their plight to document the whole thing around then. So a lot of stuff's going to get buffed or not going to survive. But I explained it to Mayor, and Mayor said, yeah, that's me and my brother, I think. And so I narrowed it down. I found out who did it. I just don't...
Kelly's and Mayor.
So even Mayor didn't have photos.
No, they didn't think to get photos. They just were trying to get up and get famous, you know?
No, of course.
Yeah, this is the Os Gemos piece down here in San Francisco. We did this in 3 days.
Wow, it's huge.
We had two lifts, and the brothers were on the top, and I was doing the Cheech. And the
that's a better angle.
Yeah, that's my car that burned up. yeah. Old Cadillac. But yeah, that piece is still there. It just, they built a hotel in front of it. So now you can just see it through the alleyway. There's like 7 feet, you know, and you can see it between the buildings. So that's like a hidden secret.
Now it's protected. Yeah.
Good. In downtown San Francisco. Yeah.
And Os Gemos, again, I'm massive fans of them. I talk a lot about Brazil because I used to live in Brazil for a little while.
They are just amazing, you know, those two guys. Hanging out with them is so inspiring.
Brings Brazil into it.
And they're another ones where their characters...
They draw, like, constantly. Like, just they'll pick up anything and draw on it, like just constantly like driven. And it's so inspiring to see that kind of energy, and you can't help to have it rub off on you, I mean, I'm the type who's like, I do this as a living, I'll get to it, these guys do it as a life force, if I really like taking it, they deserve all the big props they get.
No, I love them, man. And they're another ones where their characters are instantly recognizable, similar to Bodhi. You see him and straight away, you
They've
know.
got one of the best collections of my father's work now.
Oh, deep. Okay.
Yep, they've been buying it all up.
Actually, this was done in Brazil by my mate who's actually from Switzerland, Mr. Bean.
Oh.
He does Bodhi characters all the time. He's fucking obsessed with Bodhi characters. So I had to include him in this one, man. This was
That's
freestyle, straight off the top.
In a way that's like a portrait of me. I mean, because my father was Cheech Wizard under the hat, and I was the Lizard Apprentice, always getting kicked in the balls,
Well,
and
yeah.
and I was like, why always kicked in the balls if that's me, Dad? And he's like, because you deserves it. And it was really because I used to box with him when I was a kid, and we
Okay.
had boxing gloves. And whenever shit got heated, I'd hit him in the nuts as hard as I could. And I'd always drop him, and I'd just be like, hey! And he's like, I'm gonna get you fucker. So he started
Wow.
kicking the lizard in the balls as revenge. So that's where that comes from.
Man, that's deep.
Yeah.
Here we go. Scene.
Oh,
We've
the scene.
already brought him up.
Yeah.
He was an avid, obviously, Bodhi fan. And yeah, and you said you've collabed with him, that painting on your wall there, and he's a legend, man. I mean, damn.
We did two of these in just an hour, a couple hours, while he was getting interviewed for the Bodē documentary. I was working on my part, and then he worked on his part. But yeah, we're really good friends, and but I don't get to see him too often, but because he's so busy.
All right, is
Yeah.
another Kel
That's
maybe from
a
Shy.
whiz. What is that for the people listening? That's a wizard over a scene throw up.
Yeah, Richie did this in my black book.
Ah, nice.
Scene
That
one,
was at
baby.
the
The Spraycan Art.
Incredible.
The Spraycan Art signing.
Can we see that again? We didn't see it for long enough. That yeah,
Hold
let me
up,
see
hold up, hold
this.
up, wait, wait, wait. Hold it up, sorry,
Wait, wait,
man.
wait.
You, there you
There's
go.
more. It is a good one. Kings
Nice.
don't die, they become what?
Gods.
Gods.
Can you
That
show us
way.
the other one quickly? Because I've got you now on the main screen, if that's cool. Ah, there
Yeah.
we go.
That looks
Yeah,
nice,
man.
man. Yeah, that
Classic.
was
When
in
were those done? When were those done?
Spraycan Art signing in San Francisco.
Okay.
I mean, I got this book chalked with, I got Doctor of All.
Yes,
Ah,
sir.
nice.
Wrote the
Yes.
word.
Look, I just want to, because we've only got a couple more of these to review. This one looks like an amalgamation, like we said earlier, of a copy of a copy of a copy from back in those days, Shy and Kel.
Was that
This
Shy
one,
147? Shy
yeah.
147.
Yeah,
Yeah.
Shy was one of the first people to do Bodhi characters. I think him and Dondi were some of the earliest ones. Shy did a lot of painting in the tunnels, and I guess he got cancer at a very young age, which might have had something to do with it.
Wow.
The fact that there was no masks back then, and he was working
Exactly.
in the tunnels,
Jeez.
But yeah, I've
Oh,
always kept him in mind. Shy is one of the originators of the Bodhi characters.
and this is the last one, spin. This
Spin
one, it's a little bit been like gone through the
it.
washing machine.
It's
It's
an
come out.
alligator, dude, man.
It's an
It's
alligator, man.
an alligator, dude.
No, amazing, man. You know what? I mean, let's listen
But
to.
thanks for this as well. This thing he's got on his
Oh
desktop.
yeah, no
This is
worries.
brilliant.
I was gonna say, man, this is incredible. Thank you so much for that, man. We've got our own little. I was gonna ask maybe if it's not too
our
much
own
trouble.
Almshouse Bodē.
I could send you a bit of money. You could maybe ship this to me, man. That sketch. Oh, here we go.
These are my you know, this is my black book that I had from the 80s.
That's our friend Scheme.
Wow.
Scheme. Yeah. Scheme is legend. I saw
Had him on. Yeah, we've had him on the pod.
Yeah, I saw that. And then it's quick.
Oh man.
Amazing. I got Futura in here too somewhere.
Woo! What's this sketchbook? Is this your sketchbook from when you went to a Spraycan Art signing?
Started in 86. And it's got Mayor, it's got everybody in here. This is my personal sketchbook. I gotta like donate this to the graffiti museum or something. I don't know. It needs to be in somebody else's hands, I think, at this point. But
holy shit. Send it to us. Send it to us.
We'll take it off your hands, man.
Okay. Well, I'll spend all day trying to. There's one that I wanted to find.
You should post a few pics or something on your Instagram, man. You should keep it. You shouldn't give it to anyone else.
Yeah, I mean,
as you know.
And then of course I got the original
Dondi letters.
Wow.
Dondi, yeah. I wish we had gotten the time to work together. We would have done a lot of collabs, I'm sure. But at the time, you know, I was still
imagine if you were going to the yard with him. Doing top to bottom
in San Francisco,
Bodē.
And he was in New York, and then I was with the Ninja Turtles. I worked on the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles for 10 years almost, and my wife was did the licensing for them. So, so we were so busy. I could have been hanging with Dondi, and we went to New York all the time, like all the time, because my mother-in-law lived there. So, you know, so it's unfortunate that I missed that window with Dondi, you know, because we would have done some great things, you know.
I bet, yeah. Did you catch the new Turtles movie, the animated ones?
No.
Oh, you haven't caught that? No, okay, fair enough.
No, I mean, I was part of the whole movement when they first got big, you know, and my friends became multimillionaires overnight. And
it's insane. Yeah, it's insane what happened.
And Kevin was a Bodē fan. You know, Kevin's another celeb that the early Ninja Turtles, if you look at the comic books, they got those big
fingers. Fat fingers, three of them.
See, those all came from my father, you know, and he admits it. You know, it's like, yeah. We went on a ride of a lifetime, you know, with those guys. I mean, it was so great, you know. Like, cartoonists don't get treated like with limos and shit like that. You know? We did.
Oh man, yeah, the phenomenon.
Rock star lifestyle.
It's insane. I think there's a documentary about it as well. I'm pretty sure I saw one a while ago. I can't remember what it's called though. But yeah, insane what happened there.
Yeah, there's actually a turtle convention, 40 years of the turtles in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, in end of April, and I'm a guest, and my wife's a guest, and we're gonna be there, and it's gonna be the whole team of the original crew that did the Ninja Turtle comic books.
Yeah.
You know, when it first started. I mean, when you know before they had multicolor bands and they're gritty and like really violent.
Yeah, it was aimed towards adults. Yeah, it wasn't a kid's.
It was perfect for me. I loved it.
I bet. Yeah, man. Wow. Okay. I mean, yo, Mark. I mean, again, I don't want it to go on for too long, man. Is
no,
there anything else? Is there anything else that you wanted to mention? Like maybe something coming up or something people can go look up or.
Well, we finally, after all these years, decades and decades, finally I landed a exhibition in Tokyo. So that's coming.
Okay.
There's going to be a Bodē Universe exhibition in Tokyo.
In Tokyo.
Yeah, in May, you know, this year. So I'm gearing up for that. You know, the curator, Alex Mitchell, he's good friends with the Otomo family that did Akira.
Oh, wow.
And
My favorite, man.
Chuy Otomo is going to do a Cheech Wizard. He's going to do a Cheech
Oh,
Wizard for the
shit.
show.
Oh,
So
my God.
we'll be rubbing elbows with, with the Otomo. So that'd be fucking,
Jesus.
I mean, wow, how did I get here? It's just it's the magic of the hat. The hat opens doors. It has a key. It comes with a key.
Well,
And
what's this? You're going to do like a
that
whole
key, it's
universe.
that key.
You're doing a whole Bodhi universe.
Yeah, we don't want to like get too preachy with the Japanese market because we haven't really arrived there as we know. I mean, they love graffiti, but what we want to do is introduce the characters and the universe. So I'm going to build a planet that's going to have, all the little cities and towns that my father designed. I'm going to build it and it'll spin like a disco
My God.
ball in the middle of the room. And then you're introduced to the characters on canvases, life size.
Wow. Okay.
And that'll be the basis of it. And then there'll be like tributes to Cheech in the back.
Okay.
But paintings on canvas of all the
Oh,
characters.
probably, yeah. I'm not sure about
Nice.
that yet. He's putting that together.
Man,
But
that should slide in real nice because obviously they're fucking obsessed with anime
well, I
and
just want to
manga.
let them discover the world and then want more. Like we're not going to get too preachy. Like this comes from this and this comes from that.
Yeah.
You like very, very kind of discover this world and and make them hopefully want some more.
No
But
doubt, man.
I feel like we've carried. It's like carrying a dead man on your shoulders up a mountain.
Wow.
It's not easy. Then you get to the top and you go, ah, this
Done
scares you, Cheech Wizard, you fucker.
Jeez, yeah. Wow,
But it's
yeah,
like,
man.
I'm really like just wearing two hats, and whenever I work on my stuff too much, my father's stuff starts sliding away. Like, we're finally getting the complete Dead Bone Erotica is coming out this fall from Image Streamline.
I think I
And
got it, the image here somewhere. I think this
yes,
one, yeah.
I think we're actually going to change the cover, but that's the book. And this is finally coming out. I mean, it's really hard for me to stop doing what I'm doing and pay my bills to working on dad's stuff for months and not getting any kind of advance, to work, to stop work,
No, of course.
These days it's really not, the advances aren't very big on a lot of books. So this one is the magic one. It's coming out and
Sweet.
I'll
We'll.
be posting this all over my sites,
Yeah, man.
many people to order because it'll be pretty much online ordering and comic book stores, which there aren't many left,
No, exactly.
Most people
But people can
be
people
on
get it
Amazon.
from your Instagram? People can get it from your Instagram straight away.
Well, yeah, they can order it or I'll post the links. Yeah,
Yeah.
absolutely. But I'm not going to do this till fall, but
Yeah, no,
right now
we'll keep an eye on it, man. We'll keep an eye
I'm
for
putting all
sure.
the book together, but yeah, I just keeping the old man alive, and
Mark,
I love doing it.
you do a good job, and we can tell that you love doing it and that you're not, your enthusiasm is infectious. Okay. So,
He's
yeah, there he
on
is. Great that you still do
my shoulder. He's
it.
like, Mark, what are you doing with my ships?
No. No doubt, man. Yo, Mr. Bodie, thank you so much, man, for joining us. Really, it's an honor and a pleasure, man. Thank you so much. I was wondering if I could trouble you just now, if you could say, yo, this is Mark Bodie. You're listening to Arms House to your mum's house.
Okay.
Go for it.
Oh, this is Bodie. You're listening to almshouse from your mom's house.
No, wait, I beg you one more time. It's almshouse. It's almshouse to your mom's house.
You've got
to
keep that in. You've got to keep that in. You go, no, I beg you. One more time. Then the video ends.
What did I do wrong?
You said almshouse from your mom's house. It's almshouse to your mom's house.
Okay. This is Odie, and you are looking at almshouse from your mom's house.
You know what? That's good enough, brother, man. Thank you so much, bro.
Oh, I said from again.
Yeah.
No, We're keeping it.
It's all love, man. Thank you again, man. Thank you so much. And just for the people, we're going to go out to some Led Zeppelin because I know you said that your dad was a big fan, right?
Yes.
That's the stuff he would have been listening to while sketching out and drawing.
Oh, he had the big white headphones on.
Yeah.
And he had his turntable right next to his drawing board. And he just keep putting the needle back to the beginning. He wouldn't even bother flipping it. He just like listened to it over and over and over and over again.
Wow. Incredible, man.
Real recognize real on the creative level.
Ready.
Yo.
Thanks for the props. And, you know, I'm glad this came about. And finish your tattoo. I'll come out of retirement and finish your tattoo.
Yeah, okay, cool. I'll hold
fix
you
up, you pussy.
Yeah. Much love, man. Peace, brother.
Thank you.
Think I need to go and paint that yellow BR, bruv.